There it is.
Okay, good. So hello, everybody. Hello, everybody who's watching. Today we're here with Daniel Jeffries and Guillermo Villanueva, and also with Marcus. And yeah, we will be talking about identification in the future. And you will get to know Daniel and Guillermo a little bit more. They're both into the Fermat project, and yeah.
Cool. Yeah. I don't know where we go from that, but we'll just pick it up. Question.
Maybe guys. Hello guys. Maybe I start with some questions.
Sure.
First, I like to have a kind of introduction, so, and some simple questions to warm it up a little bit, and that the people get to know you better. So first, most people know me maybe from my project, because I'm the community face, or Sarah, she's the community face, but I'm the responsible for the community. So we better start off with Guillermo, yeah? Guillermo, I'd like to know from you first where you are from and what is a little bit your background. Just make a very quick introduction so that we know where you're starting from.
Okay. I am from Argentina. I work in IT from almost 35 years right now, mostly in the Latin American region, and also in US. I work in the past for Microsoft, and one of the things that was under my responsibility was many things related to identity. So I am very interested in meet Daniel. I have read his white paper. I like it very much. I very excited to share some ideas and probably collaborate with him. I am working with the Fermat project from the very beginning. At the moment that Luis started with the project, I don't remember when. I probably 2 or 2 years and a half ago. I've been working in the Fermat project as an advisor, and I am starting to transition to a more active role in the project during the next month.
So you take over now the role as a system architect until we find maybe another person, but you will now start getting active and yes, help the project to set up.
At least I am going to help with this, and also with some other aspect that I believe that we had to organize better in order to set a clear roadmap for the entire project.
Yeah, very cool. Thank you. So, okay, let's head to the next person here in our talk. And Daniel Jeffries, please introduce yourself.
So I'm here in the States in San Diego. I've been in tech since I got out of college, so about almost 20 years now. I BS'd my way into my first job out of college because I actually had no training in computers. I was working as the assistant to the secretary at a tech company, and I went to the tech guy and I said, teach me everything that you know. And he would just tear apart the computer and he'd say, you know, put it back together and don't ask me any questions unless you absolutely have to. And so I did, and then I got my first job during the dot-com boom and spent all my nights there figuring out all the shit I said I knew how to do. But then that was actually being able to just figure things out. A bit of an autodidact, I guess. I like to teach things to myself. So, you know, I had a consulting company for a decade. I moved on to major upstream open source vendor where I'm at now. I'm also a science fiction writer. So a lot of the early ideas I had for this stuff came out of a book that I wrote called The Jasmine Wars, which is about China throwing off communism and having a revolution, basically, and a civil war, and creating a direct democracy. And they were running basically a huge sort of decentralized application platform to do it. And initially I sat down and thought, like, you know, could we actually do anything like this today? Like, we have a lot of the technologies, but could we do it? Like, could it be architected? Is it feasible? And what would it look like? And so I spent about a year sort of staring at my whiteboard and running into brick walls, trying to figure out, you know, what we had done correctly and what we were missing. Because a lot of the like the cryptocurrencies and things like that are quite good, and they represent a real breakthrough, but they hadn't quite caught on to the level that I had expected. And so I spent a lot of time trying to figure out what are the flaws, like what is keeping it back from getting into the absolute mainstream. And I think, you know, I think I came up with some fairly good answers. They're probably not the only answers that anyone will ever come up with, but my sense is that, you know, Bitcoin and Ethereum and things like that are really represent 1.0 technologies. They're awesome. They're massive breakthroughs, but they certainly are not the last scenario. That would essentially be like saying, you know, Windows 1.0 is the last operating system we ever need. Like, it will develop further, and to do that, I think we have to do a number of things fundamentally different. And really, to this point, all we've seen is really a series of iterations on the Bitcoin code, right? And I call that the Satoshi box, which is where you solve a previously unsolvable problem, and then everybody leaps into the new block, the new box, right? We just move the chains a little bit, and everybody gets stuck in thinking, well, this is the only way to do it. And eventually you have to leap out of that box as well in order to create sort of a true innovation. So anyway, that's my history there.
Okay, cool. I saw you have a lot of stuff what you are doing, not only IT consulting, and you're a serial entrepreneur. You talked a little bit about your activities. So I saw that you were writing or came up with a kind of a common sense diet. So you're also into, are you into cooking or tell us something about that. I was really fascinated reading this article on Medium from you.
I have probably books. Some writers are worried about like writer's block and you know, what are they going to write next? I'm just hoping to live long enough to write all of the stuff that I want to write. So I have a long backlog, including several nonfiction projects, and one of them is what I call the common sense diet. And that was really, I started looking around at diets as I got into my late 30s, and my metabolism slowed down, right? And I decided, you know, what do all these diets have in common? And in fact, that's generally my approach to life, what I call sort of looking at meta patterns. I think people get very focused and they get very religious about a particular stance, right, or a particular thing in life. So it's either Bitcoin or nothing, it's Ethereum or nothing, it's paleo diets or nothing, it's vegetarianism or nothing, right? And these are really self-limiting belief systems. The fact is, all of these systems exist simultaneously, and you know, you can be healthy in a number of different ways, right? And so what I wanted to look for was like, what do all these diets agree on? Like, what is paleo, you know, and what do vegetarianism agree on? And you'd think, well, nothing, right? Because paleo is all about like hunting and eating as much meat as possible, right? Being a manly man, right? And vegetarianism is like, oh, we shouldn't harm anything and never hurt an animal, right? But the truth is, both of those diets like absolutely agree that you should be eating a lot of vegetables, right? Like, in fact, no diet essentially says like vegetables are bad, right? And so that's what I tended to look for. And the last thing I'll sort of say about that is, I think that diets are about, the best diet is really about longevity, right? Weight loss is sort of a happy accident that you get out of it, but it's an end state. So when you get to that weight loss, people tend to go, oh, well, I got my goal, I'm done. So I'll just go back to eating a cheeseburger and every day. Whereas if your end state is longevity, which is something I think, you know, the ancient folks and really understood better, then it has no end state until you're in the ground, right? And so that's what I think is a better focus for people.
That's absolutely interesting to hear. I love this approach. I really do. And it makes total sense.
Thank you.
Marcus, did you want to ask another question?
No, normally not. I mean, you said you're also an author and writer. This is maybe still what I like to explore a little bit about you. You're writing science fiction. Is it right? So,
what is So I have this Chinese Civil War saga that's ongoing and it's probably going to consume the next decade of my life. It's sort of a ridiculous project to get yourself involved in because at one point you realize this is now going to dominate your thinking for the next 10 years of your life. I think very few people actually understand what that means to do something over a very long period of time. A lot of people would like to think that they do, but it's very challenging to kind of steel yourself up for a long haul. Probably the best book ever written on that struggle is called The War of Art, not the Art of War, but The War of Art by Stephen Pressfield. He wrote The Legend of Bagger Vance and other great things, but he really talks about the resistance, I think, that any entrepreneur or writer or anyone who sets about to do something that actually is of a higher order, that you're going to face resistance. If you want to do nothing and exist sort of in a crappy job and like marry the wrong person and just kind of drift through life, you won't face any resistance whatsoever from fear or higher order. But if you want to start a new enterprise, if you want to build a world-changing application, if you want to write a long novel, you're going to face a lot of fear, right? And you're going to have to push through that in order to do those things, right? And so, the Jasmine Wars is really represents my views on life, and it was an idea that it goes back to, just being drunk on my friend's balcony in New York City and looking out over the city and seeing the world as the city as a giant biocomputer. And from there, I started to imagine organic technology and how technology would develop. And for some reason, I focused on China as kind of the next place in the world, 20 or 30 years ago. And I was sort of fascinated with that country and what it would look like to kind of write an epic war saga that took place there. So that idea has been sort of gesticulating in the brain for many years. And I finally had, the artistic chops to sit down and start writing it.
Yeah, cool. So hopefully Fermat and your Cicada project will occupy the next decade of your life too. I think Guillermo, he knows what you're talking about excellently well, because Guillermo is also a person who is thinking in decades. So the Fermat project is maybe just the beginning to something that is far, far, far in the future. And we today are sitting here together to talk and pre-mine those futural things that are going to happen. And what it means to sacrifice parts of your life, whole decades of your life, just for one or two projects maybe. So this is what brings us together here to this place. So from my personal side, I don't know, Sarah, if you want to contribute something now at this point, but I'm quite happy and satisfied about the introduction around, and maybe we just start and go directly into digging deep into the topics we wanted to talk about. So okay.
Yeah, absolutely. I think we should start. Maybe you, Daniel, can maybe explain what your project, your idea was with Cicada.
Sure.
Can you explain that?
Yeah, I mean, and we'll just kind of use that as a way to dive into identity, because I'm, very interested in everyone else's ideas on it. Frankly, I never thought I would meet anyone who would actually be interested in it, or so I really just started writing about it in the event that, the ideas would eventually percolate out into the universe after, after I was gone. Maybe somebody would find it and think, oh, that was a great idea that dead guy had 100 years ago. Maybe we should do this. So the basic concept that I was trying to solve when I was thinking about Cicada, and this is slightly different from Fermat, but I think that the issues roll in together, right? Which is why I've been excited about the Fermat project, is I was trying to solve a very specific problem. What would a distributed voting platform look like? With a representative-less government, right, where you didn't necessarily have a set of representatives acting as a proxy for yourself, and how would you enforce one person, one vote, and how would you make the thing secure? How would you make it unhackable? How would you make it something that one ideology couldn't dominate? I think the history of the world is a series of ideologies trying to dominate each other. And actually, the world is much better when many ideologies are competing. In fact, any time that a single ideology ends up dominating the others, what you have is a period of stagnation in history, right? You have a period of closed-mindedness. We may be going into a period like that now with a sort of rise of like very arrogant populists and sort of ultra-nationalists, right? Things like that. You're going into this sort of closed era. And so the idea was, how can you build a system that survives those sort of areas, those eras of darkness, right? Isaac Asimov had a similar idea in the Foundation series, right? Where they were trying to write down all the knowledge before and preserve it before they went into a period of sort of like of darkness, right? And so the concept of identity became foundational to Cicada because I need to find a way to enforce one person, one vote. And I needed also to find a way to what I thought were some of the challenges in Bitcoin, which are distributing the wealth unevenly, right? And so what you have now is Bitcoin was trying to solve this problem of over-centralization with banks and things like that. And now it's essentially the same problem. It's just now these giant miners with ASICs who are basically unaccountable. And so it's actually a worse problem. It's essentially the same problem. And so my concept was to take Cicada, build a decentralized identity system, in other words, a human unique identifier, one person, one vote, while still paradoxically preserving people's privacy, which is all of these things are, they seem sort of antithetical to each other. They're very problematic to solve. And then the concept was to unify the client and miner so that a person can only have a single miner, and then randomly draft people into pools, so that the wealth would essentially just be distributed randomly apart without the network, and you would secure the network for every person who joins, right? So it solves the centralization problem, at least in theory, right? It doesn't allow for collusion because it's random. And in addition to that, I wanted to bring to the concept another problem. I wanted to solve another problem that I see, and that is one of the reasons I think cryptocurrencies have not taken off past a small niche group of technologists is that it's a cryptocurrency first and a platform second. And what do I mean by that? I mean that you have this currency and it's a great idea, but they're trying to graft these platforms on top of it. So everything you do on the network costs money. You want to talk to somebody, costs money. You want to vote, costs money. In the real world, none of these things cost money. I want to start a website, chat with my friends, whatever, these things are free. And so I introduced a concept that I call action tokens, which are essentially dynamically generated on the network. And they're essentially processed by everyone on the network, and they allow for free transactions. So what I envision is an app platform first and a cryptocurrency second. In other words, I imagine just an application that I get on, I can do encrypted chat. It's all decentralized, right? It's like having Lambda without AWS, right? You have this application, you're chatting, you're forming groups, it's like, imagine like Slack and Signal and the internet all kind of woven into a single application, and all of a sudden you look and you have this wallet after you've been doing things for free, just like a normal application, and you find, oh my God, there are these little coin thingies in it, this funny money, and I can do additional things with it, right? And so for me, if people just have an application that's interesting and they can use it without having to go acquire funny money and then do something, which is a non-starter for the average person. It just won't happen. Nobody's going to go figure out how to trade for money, load up their account, then load an application and do something. It's not going to happen. It's only in the dreams of people's mind that it would happen in that direction. It's too much of a technical hurdle. But if you create an application that everybody can use, doing normal things, and it's a killer app that everybody wants to use, then all of a sudden you have a Trojan horse that allows cryptocurrency to be utilized, in fact, multiple cryptocurrencies. And so that was the concept behind it. And probably the least understood piece of it was the identity platform. That's where I got the most questions. And essentially those questions were, you can't build a decentralized app platform or a decentralized identity. It's impossible. You have to have a centralized authority. And I just think that it's a very limited way of thinking about the world. And the problem with any real new invention is that people have no reference point for it in the past, and so it's overlooked, right? when sort of Mendel comes out and proves that like genetic evolution works, he eventually just says screw it and goes back to being a monk because he doesn't want to deal with the problem of having to say no. Like this actually works. I've just proven it in this experiment that if you keep mating these plants, they're going to change over time, right? So these types of discoveries are really hard to push through. And thinking about the world in a fundamentally different way is very hard to push through because people only have their previous reference points to deal with, right? But I think this is a fundamentally important problem to solve because millions, you know, billions of people on the planet don't have a centralized, don't have an identification. And, or the ones that are starting to be developed are being developed by private organizations with algorithms that are not open, that are closed, with running on platforms that are closed that we have no insight into, no security audits, right? And this is happening already. Banks are doing it using biometrics. Companies are doing it in India, where every single citizen of a billion people is getting a biometric identity right now. This stuff is already happening. So when I say that the system is going to be built whether we like it or not, I'm not speculating. It is happening already. And so my feeling is that we need to build a decentralized identity system as a moral imperative. It has to happen because it has to be something that's open and not controlled by a few entities. So I tend to be long-winded. I'm going to shut up now. I'd love to hear from everyone else on the subject.
Yeah, I would love Guillermo's opinion on that.
Sarah, I don't know if it's only me, but I am hearing you very bad.
Sarah, she cuts in and out just a little bit.
Okay. But can you hear me good now, or is it not so good?
Yes, I can hear you, but
okay.
It's a little echoey. It's not the end of the world, though. It's just a little echoey.
Okay, let's just go ahead. I mean, Guillermo, I'd like to listen from you what your viewpoint is about this topic. I mean, this was a great introduction from Daniel about, it was quite the whole picture, just roughly pulled out. But okay, Guillermo, what do you think about this topic about the human identifier and identity?
Honestly, we were working in exactly the same direction that Daniel. I feel very comfortable with what I saw in the white paper. I have some doubts about some aspects that he is stating in the white paper, but. In general, we are very, very aligned with those ideas. I think that we have some additional challenge. In my understanding, in the white paper, Daniel is mentioning that you had two different layers. One is the biometric layer in order to create the primary identity of the person, and then you have a reputation system to have an more strong identity, or to make sure that the person is who they say to. He is. In the conceptual level, we are totally aligned. I have a couple of questions. For example, you are mentioned that you prefer to use the iris recognition. Mm. And my question is, do you believe that we have the technology in place to give that to bring this kind of identification to the masses? Because, for example, we are talking through our laptops, and I really don't know if we can scan the iris using a regular device or a regular phone. It's important to, I agree with you that this is probably one of the more secure biometrics ways, but at the same time, I don't know if we are prepared to deliver this to the masses.
So I mean, so that's a good point. And as I noted, I tend to think pretty far in advance. And so I see sort of iris scanning becoming ubiquitous. In fact, it stood a chance to become ubiquitous with the Galaxy S7 before it started blowing up, and that kind of set back the timetable, right? But the Galaxy S8 is on its way out. Its iris scan is already built in. And so that signals to me that the technology is at least cheap enough to start becoming ubiquitous. But you're absolutely right that the technology is not ubiquitous yet. And so my answer to that is relatively simple, right? That you don't have to wait for iris technology, right? You can build an identity system now with sunset provisions for specific identities as things change, right? In the same way that sort of Bitcoin or any of the cryptos have kind of a sunset provision on, that's not really the best way to describe it, but sort of you can say, well, this crypto is now no longer secure, right? If quantum computers come out tomorrow and make elliptical curve insecure, right, they have the ability to change that out. And so the same thing can be done, I believe, at the biometric level. And so you can create these kind of, these passwords that have a limited trust, or these identities that have a limited trust for a period of time. Right, and they could be expired or require a person to upgrade as the technology advances. And in fact, the identity should be a living system that adapts to to what people are doing, and primarily, the biometrics I believe are there as a prevention against fraud in some respects. Right, and that is right now when you get your identity stolen, there's not much you can do. Okay, my sister had her identity stolen. They put all the alerts on her card. Every time somebody is supposed to open a new card, they were supposed to call her, except they don't always, and sometimes the attackers get through. And that's what these guys do, right? They steal a bunch of cards, and then they just keep opening new ones, and they steal identities, and they just keep opening transactions, and eventually, two or three of them get through. It's essentially a brute force kind of spam attack. And so right now, there's really nothing to prevent that. Whereas if you build sort of a blockchain-based identity based on the biometrics, you have several sort of, you have the ability to prove after your identity has been stolen, either through a kind of a proof of stake bonded entity or through a court system like, hey, by the way, I actually own this eye. It's right here. You can scan me. And kind of you with the court system, for instance, would be able to say, okay, the old identity is flagged, right? It's dirty now, right? And no longer can be used for transactions. And I've initiated the new key generation, right? And so I liked iris scan from the simplicity of that. Originally, I felt like, a thumbprint was the ideal way to go. And then I realized, because that technology is more ubiquitous, the main challenge with it is that it's very hard to say, like, I didn't just create 10 identities, right? With my 10 fingers. It's also, your finger changes dramatically kind of over time. Like if you cut your finger, if it's wet. Right now on my Google Pixel phone, I have a fingerprint identity system. And if my finger's slightly wet, if it has oil on it, if it has lotion on it, it doesn't work, right? It has a high false positive rate. So again, I'm not married to that idea. I see that as the long range function, but I'm also far-sighted enough to say iris scanning isn't the end all be all as well, right? There's something else down the line that we can't foresee. And for me, the best way to design a system is to design it with the idea that it will be in flux, that it will evolve over time. That to me is the most dynamic system, right? That the biometric system in and of itself, people tend to focus on the specifics, but I can tell already that you're focusing on the meta pattern. And that's where when people kind of critique my stuff and they go, well, you haven't figured out every little thing. Of course I haven't figured out every friggin' thing, right? I mean, this is a starting point. I just sat down and went further than I think most people had with it, right? But those things are, but these pieces can be swapped out. And the meta pattern is, I think, holds true regardless, right? In other words, if somebody pops in and says, well, you know what, now there's a big old series of attacks on iris scans become ubiquitous. There's a series of attacks on iris scans. The system has to be flexible enough to swap out that iris scan for something that's more secure at whatever happens in the future, right? You want to build a system that lasts for hundreds of years and can be upgraded without a painful process. That's the real challenge that most people have not solved. So I don't think we're in a disagreement on that at all.
Yes,
yes, go ahead, Magnus.
I think you're quite right, Daniel. We need to have a kind of trust-based system with different trust levels, even trust levels of the ID. I mean, Samsung S8, I will be a proud user of that phone next week. It's on the way to me, and it uses this iris scan. So I'm happy to try it out. But certainly the iris scan is should not be the only identifier, biometric identifier, because you can have a bad accident and lose your eyes. And yep. Suddenly you cannot access your funds anymore. But maybe you have different trust levels and different ID possibilities. And I don't see any problem in that. I mean, my banking app is using my hand pattern.
Yeah.
It's scanning my hand with my camera and just uses all the patterns. That's freaking good. Then Humanic, the blockchain project based from Luxembourg in Switzerland, they are trying to get the banking on blockchain to the unbanked people in Africa and Asia. They are using the face recognition that's working really well. And you almost cannot, it's really hard to fake it. But still, it is possible, and in the next future, it will be even more possible. But I see that we will have maybe brainwave scanners.
Sure.
It sounds utopic, but it will be possible in 10 years.
Sure.
So I think we shouldn't worry about the specific biometric itself. We should just design a system from the beginning that it's capable of having different ones, categorizing in different trust levels. I mean, just the fingerprint is very trustworthy, but not ultimately. Maybe your voice recognition and whatever, what is convenient and what we can at that point bring to the masses. So we shouldn't care a lot about what we are measuring, but that we are capable of measuring it and that we can change it, that it can evolve over time. I totally agree with Daniel on that point. I like it. And from that moment, we are already in the big topic of reputation as well, because I think trust and ID could have reputation as well. How do we dig in now into the reputation topic? So Daniel, maybe, or Guillermo, go ahead.
You know, I'll say a quick summary of it, and then I'd love to hear Guillermo's ideas on it, right? My quick summary is simple. I think it's very important to level set when I am talking about reputation. The words that are coming out of my mouth are not the words that most people are hearing, right? They have an idea pre-built in of what a reputation system is, okay? And they immediately go and start imagining kind of a Yelp system, an Uber system where you rate your driver and he rates you. That's really what I consider a 1.0 reputation system. Right, and so that's not what I am thinking of. In fact, I got into a little flame war on Medium before the Medium police flagged me and told me I was escalating with a troll. That your thing can't work because we'll just trade reputation back and forth. And I'm like, that is you actually didn't read a single word of the paper because I already said that's not what it is at all. And that is exactly true. Like when I get out of an Uber, first thing I'm thinking is if this guy wasn't totally horrible, I want to just give him 5 stars as a defensive rating, right? Because I don't want him giving me 5 stars. And the system has become almost ridiculous. It's minorly valuable, but only to a certain degree, whereas like the reputation system on an Uber goes from like 4.7 to 5 as reasonable, right? In other words, if you start to get below 4.7, you could even be let go. So it's a 5-star reputation system, quote unquote, where only 0.3 now matters because of defensive trading, right? So my system, the way I thought about it more was an algorithmic system at multiple layers of the system, okay? And that is, as a series of basically Turing tests for humans, right? And that, and so like at a network level, right, you're essentially saying like, hey, I've interacted with this person, so automatically that's kind of a bump to my reputation, right? I've started chatting with this person, that's a bump to my reputation, right? Whereas at the networking level, if nodes start attacking me, there's a series of networking rule sets, right? In the blockchain, think of it as kind of like a firewall slash intrusion detection system that's dynamically updated, right? Kind of like as if GitHub were running in blockchain, or a series of firewall and intrusion detections were running there. And it kind of pulls down those rules, and you as another node might have to prove that you're running the latest rule set cryptographically. And if you're not, hit to your reputation system automatically. This is not something where people are voting. This is not Black Mirror. This is not, hey, you've got a really cool smile and I like your dress style, right? You know, and we're gonna just trade these votes, right? That's, there is a small percentage of that that's useful at the business level, but a deeper reputation system is one that is algorithmic, that it functions at the network level, it functions at the level of human interaction. And then in addition to that, as I start to use the ID in the real world, and the system becomes more ubiquitous. And now imagine I'm using my identity to go work for a company. A company is not just going to allow, you know, me to impersonate a random human being that I made up, right? They're going to look into my background. They're going to interview me. They're going to do, in essence, a Turing test. Do I exist? Am I really doing stuff that's valuable to their company? And if they decide to hire me, and that then they would give weight to that they would use their reputation's weight to add to mine, right? Which would give me kind of a different level of trust on that network, right? And so those types of things, as these centralized identities develop inevitably and a decentralized system, then they can add weight, right, to people's IDs that say that they're real. And so that, in my mind, is how eventually a reputation bank works. And again, whether I figured out every aspect of it, I don't think that I have, but I know that the broad patterns of that would generally work and would have stronger fraud prevention than what we have now. What we have now is strong control when we create the ID and no control afterwards. And so I'm arguing to weaken the control slightly on the creation phase and strengthen the control on the using phase, right? And again, doing it in a way that is careful, because what we don't want is this system, if used poorly, could be used in a very authoritarian way, and we want to make sure that we design the system in such a way that it benefits people, across the world, as opposed to being something where you can sort of track and control and decide who is a valid person and who is not, right? And that's something we don't want. So you have to be careful in terms of the design of this.
Daniel. I agree with you with the way that you are addressing the reputation system to support or to have an strongest identity. But I believe that we have an additional challenge, because one of the things that we are very interesting in the work that you are doing is because for us is the one of the critical pillars of the governance systems. And in the governance system, one of the things that we had to do is to measure the value that people brings to the community. For example, if you collaborate with something, code, marketing, or whatever, and you increase the value of the network itself, you had to be rewarded in two different ways. One, with tokens. This is the monetary part of the rewarding. And second, improving your reputation, at least in one specific domain. For example, if you are contributing code and the community judges the code as a very well contribution, your reputation as developer will increase. Do you believe that the reputation approach that you describe in the white paper is well suitable for this kind of scenarios?
I do. I think that, and I would say we have to be cautious as well in that scenario, right? So that scenario is absolutely a valid scenario. It's also one that potentially can miss other types of contributions, right? And so, a classic example, I'll tell you what, every company that I've ever worked with, most algorithms are gonna miss my contribution to the system, right? Primarily because I'm a bit solipsistic, right? As an author, I tend to be a slightly isolationist, right? I'm not a sort of like, my default programming, if you will, is not extrovert based, right? It's not community based. And at the same time, I also think that, whereas my bosses or the people I've worked with will say, oh, Dan's very valuable. Well, how do you quantify that? I don't know, right? And so, I just like talking to him and he seems really smart. So go ask him a question, right? And so there's a kind of a weird intrinsic value. And so I think as we, as a system is designed, it's important to think about like all of the aspects of what sort of makes something valuable or makes a person valuable or makes a person's reputation solid. Right? And some of these things are very easy to capture in an algorithm. Like you mentioned, essentially two heuristics, right? Did they contribute and did people like the code? And so I would say, yeah, it absolutely can, it would absolutely be valuable on that front. And at the same time, I'd also say we have to think about the fact that somebody could contribute code that everybody hates that is actually valuable, right? In other words, the code might be in some way confrontational, but might actually be better for the network. And so therefore it doesn't gain consensus. Right, and you see these types of things play out all the time. Right, a good example is the Ghost in the Shell movie that just came out. As a science fiction writer, I really enjoyed the movie, and but it came out with a lot of controversy. Right, there was a lot of controversy around it. The character development wasn't great, but there was sort of this. A sort of predisposition to kind of hate the movie based on all of the controversy that had come out before. And I think that what happens is that kind of blinds people to some of the merits of the movie, regardless of the controversy about Scarlett Johansson and the character. I thought the world building was magnificent. I mean, as a sci-fi writer, I looked at it and I was just in love. I was wishing I had it on DVD or a Blu-ray already so I could slow it down and look at each frame individually. I could care less almost about the story at this point. And so what I'm saying is that sometimes there are contributions that may or may not be seen currently as valuable by the wider community, right? If you think about even like when Satoshi puts out his original paper, five people understood that, right? And said this is valuable. But if you would put that to like a wider view of a larger community of programmers who perhaps had no understanding of these concepts, they're not widely disseminated, they might all decide that he's a jackass, right, with no value whatsoever. So there's this weird kind of balance that has to happen, right? And the way that I always try to think about these things is I always think about how can I subvert or destroy the system that I am creating, right? In other words, if I am a malicious entity, how do I ruin the system that I'm trying to build? In other words, if the only way to build a system effectively, I think, is to figure out all the ways to attack it. And you have to figure out how all the ideologies would attack it out there as well. How would they subvert it? How would they game that system, right? In other words, could they, on a back channel, start saying, hey, with all of their buddies, please go and vote up my code. My code's awesome, right? And maybe that's happening to a mailing list or a Twitter following, right? So all these types of things, I think, you want to build in a system that changes over time, where the rules adapt over time, and where you're trying to figure out all the ways to kind of screw it up, basically. I think that's the key.
Yes, but I agree with you. One of the things that we are thinking on is to, and for this reason, we are linking the reputation with the, or we are thinking on this, no? We have not implemented this yet. But one of the things that we are thinking on is to link the voting power to the, your reputation in some specific domain. For sure, you are, and you cannot be an expert on everything, and you are going to have a different level of reputation in different domains. And the idea is to link your voting power in one specific domain to your reputation. And the in the other hand, our system has to deal with the diversity, because even when the community can reach the consensus, consensus means that the majority of the people agree on something, right. But yeah, you have a minority that is not in agreement. What we are trying to do is to design a system that can deal with this diversity. For us, it's perfectly fine if the minority wants to do some fork and code your own version, but preserving the entire system. Mm. We don't have to. We want to enable to have diversity, but inside the whole system. So, do you believe that with these two elements, we can address the problem that you described? Because probably some part of the developer community will hate your code, but probably the majority will love your code.
Yeah.
And we can reach the consensus and also split. I had two different versions, two different flavors of the same thing.
So I think there's one addition. So I think those things can go a long way towards approximating. And in general, there is wisdom in the crowds, right? The vast majority of things, when I go to Rotten Tomatoes and look at what the critical consensus is, I can tell it's going to be pretty good. Or I might find that, for instance, for a superhero movie, which I particularly like, that the critics hated it, but the audience really loved it. There's a delta there. And so I'm going to trust probably the audience, right? And so there is wisdom in the crowds, but there is every so often kind of the movie that slips through that, everybody hated and I particularly loved or was going to be loved later, right? A perfect example is something in my genre, like a classic, like Blade Runner. Everybody, the critics destroyed Blade Runner when it came out. It was considered slow. Audiences hated it. They grafted on if you know the history of it, they grafted a voiceover on top of it because nobody could follow the movie. I mean, it almost seems laughable today considering how influential it is. But I would argue that the most influential ideas are the ones that are actually the least popular in the beginning, right? And then it's very hard it is very hard to differentiate between an unpopular idea that sucks and an unpopular idea that's actually going to gain paying power. I don't know that there's any perfect answer for that, but a third element might be interesting, and this was suggested to me by a friend in something that he saw, what he called, I think he read about it, I haven't actually seen it, democracy coins. And he was thinking about it in terms of, he was building a tiny home community. And if you've ever watched any of these travel channels where they have these tiny little houses and everybody's in love with, they're basically like the modern version of a trailer park, right? And so these but very elegant trailer parks. I don't hate tiny homes, anybody watching this. Okay, so but what happens when everybody would get together on a plot of land, they would have a community and they would have to decide how the hell did things happen. In other words, I want to get an air conditioner, and so I may need to do that, but it might be really loud for the people. Or I want to play my drums, but it might be loud for the people nearby. So the tyranny of the majority might say no. And so one way that they had tried to deal with that, and I think this is an example of innovative thinking, is with coins that you can vote with that allow you to basically put all, if you have 100 coins, that represents your total vote. And so if you don't just get one coin per vote, you say, I want to go ahead and say, I absolutely have to be able to play my drums, and I don't care about anything else. I'm going to put my 100 coins behind that, right? And so that I have the possibility of a divergent view or a sort of minority view of actually passing over the tyranny of the majority, right? In other words, I might not get anything else, but I might be able to play my drums even if nobody else likes it nearby, right? And so something like that where you know, I think that it's crucial to be able to think about, you know, that you create a system for 90%, right, to capture 90% of the people and get there, and then you work on that kind of other 10%, right? How do you bring in the true innovators? How do you bring in the people who aren't necessarily popular but who contribute a lot, you know, to a system, right? The non-politicians. In fact, I would argue that you don't want the pure politicians to be, you know, to be the leaders of the pack. Look where it got us already in the world. But anyway, so I think that just adding a separate element like that, that allows for kind of a smaller minority to be able to have their voice heard, I think is super important. You know, the founding fathers of the United States certainly thought it was important. They worried a lot about the tyranny of the majority, right? Because the majority is not always right. Sometimes they are, and sometimes they're totally off base, right? Again, that's because they're only working from the framework that they, of everything they've seen before. And so when something truly innovative comes along, they might miss it. Marcus, gone silent there? Or Sarah, I saw you talking, and I don't know if you were taking a call or you're...
You know, Marcus was just out of the hangout. And yeah, actually what you were talking about with the tyranny of the majority was a question from the YouTube live chat. And thank you for answering that. What I'm interested in is how do you two guys see Cicada project and IUP connected in some way? Is there a possibility to connect these two things?
I think so. I mean, but I don't know, Guillermo, what did you thought?
Let me see if I understand, because I am hearing very bad. The question is if we see some connection points between the Fermat project and the Cicada project. Is that the question?
That's the question.
From my perspective, the answer is absolutely yes.
For me, yeah, absolutely as well. Whether the two systems exist independently or whether they just coalesce, I mean, as I said earlier, I never thought that anyone would actually start working on Cicada, and when I started to put the ideas out there, what I inevitably would get were, you know, coders coming to me and going, dude, this is so brilliant, I want to do this, and I go, cool, it's going to take 10 years, and they go, awesome, I'm on board, no problem, right? And then they start working on it, and about a month later, they go, oh, you were serious, like, it's going to take 10 years, fuck this, right? And so they in the back of their mind, they're thinking, oh, I'll just go snatch some code from Bitcoin. You know, I'll go read a couple of other blog posts on this. I'll grab some shit from Stack Exchange, and suddenly I'll hack together this system. And that's just not the way it is. So when I sort of saw Fermat, I was happy to roll, you know, as many of the ideas into there as possible, because, you know, Lewis had really gone, I think, much further than I had in terms of, you know, raising money, you know, bringing in Guillermo and other folks to start coding on it. I may be the worst coder in the world. Not the world, but close to it. Like, if there's a contest for worst coder, like, I'm up there. I'm a pretty good system architect, and I've been working with systems for a long time. But, like, you know, my Bash is passable. My Python, you know, I can do some bubble sorts if I'm looking at that tutorial. But this type of thing is just not something that can be done by an individual or even a small collective of people, right? It needs to have competing ideas. It needs to have a lot of people. And so absolutely the things could coexist. And there's a possibility even that Cicada becomes its sort of own thing at a later date, or one day I just wake up and say, you know, I'm dying and this is the most important thing in the world to me, so I'm going to go raise 10 million bucks and dedicate every waking second to it. So I don't know what the future will bring. But at this point, I'm just excited to have, you know, be a part of Fermat and be able to help influence, even if it diverges radically, you know, from my ideas. I like what the, you know, Fermat Project is doing, and I like where it's going, and I feel we're just sort of you know, we're sisters of another mother, if you will. So.
Okay, let me hold in here a little bit. I just wanted to say that after now knowing both possible solutions for this identity problem, one from Fermat and one from you, Daniel, from the Cicada project, I absolutely see no problem why we shouldn't really collaborate, and not even collaborate, we should maybe even assimilate. The thing what Daniel is describing is more the theoretical concept which it's maybe governance 22, while Guillermo and we here in Fermat are thinking more about the pure identity and privacy problem, and we think in governance 3.0 or governance 21. What we are developing maybe takes another 2 years. We know it's a multi-year project. And what we are trying to solve is hard, it's difficult, but it's solvable. What Daniel was thinking is a working world in maybe we need 20 years for that. Huh? But to solve the problems Daniel's thinking, we need to have the new governance that Fermat is already trying to develop. For example, maybe we can approach this goal by, like an onion, the slide by slide, and getting more and more to the governance or to the identity Cicada project world. When we start at Fermat now, we have to solve a specific problem, and this is doable in a year maybe, or quicker. First, we need to set up a kind of weight-based identity system, or reputation system, sorry, a weight-based reputation system, where you have maybe voting power to give reputation, but also you can ruin your reputation in no matter what, when you're robbing a bank or killing a person or something. And when you're just by collaborating and having contact to other groups, to peers, you gain weight and your reputation gets bigger. This is something we can maybe solve very quickly, maybe in some years, and it's working. What we can do next year or tomorrow, what we can start with now, is solving the problem that each person should own its own identity, or has its own identity, but could have different personalities, present profiles, presenting to the outworld. Daniel is a science fiction author, but he's also a computer consultant. But he's also a good thinker and visionary. So in each field, he maybe has different reputation. 5 stars, yes. For this one for philosophy and so on, with just 1 star for computer.
One star for sci-fi.
Yes. This is very important. We should solve this one quickly, and we can. And if we solve this one, we have immediately solved a lot of problems out there, and then we can start building our own cyberspaces in reality. Because if we get this one working, a weight-based reputation system on top of a trusted ID system, then we can get rid of all the central services from governance and whatever. And then this is solvable quite quickly. And from there, we can dream about all the things in the future. And if we solve that, Fermat is, in that point, to my opinion, unstoppable. Because each community can have its own profiles, its own reputations, its own whatever habits and its own traits. But they all have the same way in presenting their ID and guaranteeing trust. that's all about it. So what do you think about this?
Well, I am totally agree. We had to define the vision in the more ambitious and perfect way, and then we had to define the stages that we will have in order to go from the current situation to the future situation. And this is an iterative process because in the way you will also gain more knowledge and you will be able to evolve the design of the system. But we had to define the final vision and have the clarity about the final vision and the problem that we want to solve. And we are totally aligned with Daniel. And then we had to define version 1, version 2, version 3, and the time frame for any of those versions. This is something that is also going to give us credibility as a project, you know? Because we will have a roadmap totally defined. The roadmap could change over the time, but we will have some more predictable deliverables in the future. But for sure, we cannot think in one shot development. This is a huge problem.
And I agree. And I agree that, you know, if you solve the identity problem, you solved a huge amount of problems. And in fact, it has to be built in stages. And identity was, when I thought about Cicada, was the first thing that had to be solved anyway, right? And so you guys are definitely diving into the logistics, right? I have some project managers at work, and I'm always happy to say, like, I'm glad you guys are the project manager and I'm not, right? Because you know, worrying about, you know, whether this dot release fits with this dot release, fits with that, you know, library is a specific type of thinking, right? That's absolutely necessary to take a project from A to Z. But if you solve the problem, it solves a number of challenges throughout, I think, the whole world, right? And it gives credibility, you know, to what you guys are doing. And even if you only get that far, okay, it's interesting that you know, Lewis chose Fermat, right, as the name, right? Because if you think about Fermat's last theorem, right, is a problem in mathematics, right? That was historically unsolved for 354, 358 years, something like that. Only recently solved, I think, in the last decade. And, you know, the gentleman who did it spent 7 years of his life working on it, 6 years working on it, and then there was a flaw found in the proof, and he spent another year with an assistant working on it. But what's interesting is, throughout the whole history of the problem, which was a crazy ironic problem, you know, just a mathematician writing down a formula in the side of a journal and saying, oh, I've got the proof, but there's not enough space, and nobody could find the guy's proof. And also, the final proof, by the way, turned out to be, I don't know, 200 pages, right? So I'm pretty much, you know, maybe if he did have an elegant proof that was only a couple of pages, right, we'll never know what that was. But all the people who tried to crack that problem over the course of the years ended up leading to other significant developments, right? These things don't happen in isolation. So a lot of the, you know, development in algebra and, you know, linear algebra, all the types of things that are now becoming kind of essential in artificial intelligence and other types of technologies, right? These things don't happen in isolation. And so even trying to crack a part of the problem can kind of move things forward, right? And then you can't always see how those things will affect sort of later generations. I mean, think about the Bayes filter, right? A spam filter, the first thing to kind of help crack the spam problem, right? We used to build all these rules, and they'd be about 70% accurate. They were really brittle. And then somebody pulls an algorithm that a monk invented in a cave, you know, 150 years earlier, right, out of the trash bin, right, and all of a sudden is filtering spam with it, right? And so you can never, nobody can envision these things. We can always, we spend a lot of time in society and we're doing it more and more, and I'm gonna rant here for about 5 seconds. We spend a lot of time thinking negatively about all, you know, about all this, these types of things, right? Like, you know, where the world is gonna go. Automation is gonna destroy us. I'm even guilty of it, right? I have an article on, you know, the robots will take all of our jobs. It was mostly a publicity stunt. But the fact is, I don't actually think they'll take all the jobs, right? I think that they, I think they create a short-term problem and then they create new innovation. And the problem is we can always see the problems, but we can rarely kind of see the innovation that comes in the future that results in us solving an old problem. And doing boring ass drudgery work, like for the vast majority of the population, as like the way that we all spend our lives, is absolutely a problem that should be automated away, right? It's just that we need to actually be better as a society to figure out what we do. And I think we will. I think we have a short-term screw up, and then I think we kind of get to a point where we stabilize. And we can never look over the horizon far enough, no matter how far thinking we are, and see all the permutations of the future. Try describing a web developer to an 18th century farmer, right? It's impossible, right? But the internet, you know, it comes along and changes and creates all these kind of new jobs, right? It creates all these new things that we could never envision in the past, right? It's like the Luddites come in and we've got to destroy the loom. It's going to destroy everything, really? It's like the loom didn't destroy a goddamn thing. The loom actually presaged an uptick in complexity and human achievement, right? And so that's the types of things that we need to focus on the progress of these things. And even if we make less progress than we want, we enable future generations to build upon the shoulders, right? On our shoulders and develop great things.
Oh, Sarah, did you have something?
Okay. The first thing is to understand that, at least from my perspective, the Internet of People is going to have not just one single community. I envision the Internet of People as a network of interconnected communities, and any person will be working or participating in different communities. Communities in the broader sense, no? For example, you can be part of a community of artists and contribute and interact with the community of artists, but at the same time, you also use the app to get a taxi in Berlin, which is also different or have some different aspects that the app that you use to get a taxi in Buenos Aires. This is one of the key aspects that we have to understand, that we don't have just one single community in Fermat. Fermat is going to be a network of communities. And as Marcus mentioned before, you will have a different profile, and each of the profiles will be linked to a reputation in the different communities. What is the element that is common to the different profiles? You. And you have just one single identity, and for different reasons, in many ways, or in different moments, you will need to prove that you are you. For example, if you are going to vote, we had to be sure that you are not voting many times. And for that reason, we need profiles that are linked to an identity, and make sure that the identity is linked to just one single person. In addition, any community has to need to be able to define the parameters of their own governance system. Probably the governance framework will be the same for the different communities, but each community, for sure, is going to have different parameters to customize the framework to their own needs. So, at the end, the governance system that we are proposing is a tool to facilitate the development of different communities that are self-organized and obviously are decentralized and self-organized communities. For that reason, our governance system have additional channels because the governance system has to be able to manage different communities in totally different situation. I don't know if it was clear, but this is at least the main guidelines that we are starting to working on.
From my point out, no. I'm quite yes. It was a long talk, although I have no questions. I'm happy. So, are there any questions from the community, or Daniel or Guillermo? Do you have any questions?
No, just one comment. Thank you, Daniel, for joining us, and I am really excited to work together. I am going to lead the development of the governance system, and one of the important parts of the governance system is the identity system. And honestly, I would like to rely on the work that you already done and reuse all that that work in our system, because you know, our governance system is very ambitious, so we had to start delegating and reusing as many fundamental pieces we can. And identity and the job that you already done is very good.
And you know, I mean, for my part, I appreciate you guys inviting me out. You know, Lewis and everyone has been incredibly welcoming. It's been a real thrill for me to find like-minded people. It's been a pleasure to talk to almost everyone, a lot of very unique personalities you know, great ideas. And that's exciting in and of itself, right? I think sometimes you work in isolation on something for a period of time, and you wonder whether like anyone is going to give a shit about that, right?
We had to fix that.
Right. So, you know, it's quite nice, right? And I think Lewis, when I first talked to Lewis, it was very exciting because whenever I had described Cicada and whenever he had described Internet of People, both of us had to do a lot of like level setting, like, here's how I define this term. I generally describe it as thinking of like trying to describe the internet before Mozilla existed. Like, you're like, no, and people just don't get it, right? It's like, you have to say, well, you're gonna be able to buy things remotely. And they're going like, why would I give a shit about that? I'll just walk down to the street and buy it from the store, right? So when we talked, it was like, there was no level setting. Like, we just understood what we were trying to achieve. And it was definitely a meeting of the minds. And I felt a lot of that talking to all of you as well. So, you know, I appreciate you guys bringing me into your warm embrace, and you know, it's been quite exciting.
Yes, I think so too.
Daniel, are you still up to?
I missed a, you were talking and then I couldn't hear you. I don't know if anybody else could hear. I see your lips moving. Can anyone else hear her? I can't hear her at all.
Okay, Sarah, she was, Sarah was asking if you can please describe the universal income scheme in the Cicada project, because this is something we haven't touched yet. And there are some people are maybe, it's a little bit picky. It could sound like a socialist scheme. So please go ahead and explain what you mean by that.
So again, it's super important that people get really wrapped up in ideologies. It drives me fucking nuts. I can't think of anything else that drives me more insane than people getting wrapped up in their particular ideology. So let me rant a little bit here, okay? There is the sum totality of knowledge as a sphere, and we are a single freaking point on that sphere. And everybody is under the delusion that they have a complete understanding of the whole sphere. Nobody has a complete understanding of the whole sphere, right? So, you know, when people get wrapped up in, you know, socialism, you know, blah, 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 putting labels on things and not fully understanding all various aspects of life, right? So when it comes to the UBI, I call it a UBI because that is a simple way to describe the way that I wanted to fix the problem of how the cryptocurrency was metered out to everybody. And what I described earlier was that in the Bitcoin and every derivative of Bitcoin, we have the same over-centralization problem, right? It's just moved to a different spot, right? Like, we took it out of the banker's hands and put it into the hands of a bunch of, like, private companies, right? Like, we might as well have just taken it out of their hands and thrown it into the hands of the Yakuza. Like, what's the difference, right? We have the same problem. And nobody has addressed that problem. And so one of the things that I thought about was, how do we get the money out there? And the reason you want to get the money out there is not because you want to, like, uplift everyone. It's just when there's more money out there, more people can participate in the system and do fun stuff. When 12 people are hoarding half the coins, we have exactly the problem that we have now. It's essentially digital gold, right? It's like people, you don't do anything with gold, right? It's like Warren Buffett always laughs that, like, gold.
You hoard it.
You hoard it, right? It's like, yeah, that Warren Buffett always laughs about how it's this useless metal. Like, we're basically these up jump monkeys that dug this shiny thing out of the ground and go, oh, this is great. Like, I'll put this in my closet, right? Because I can't actually build anything with this. I'll go use more useful metals to build some shit with this, and I'll put this in my closet and I'll declare it valuable, right? I mean, even the systems that we had in the past, they never functioned on gold. You didn't use gold pieces. I mean, you did in the very, very distant past, but we had a gold back system, but you still use something else, right? So the way that economies work when people are not being closed-minded or ideologically based is when money is moving around, right? When people are, you know, savings are important, but also, like, me transacting a business relationship with someone is how money moves around, right? And that's how the economy works. That's how the world develops, right? That's why triple entry accounting is such a big improvement over the past. When you look back at the history of accounting, double entry accounting was a massive breakthrough. We've only had three breakthroughs now in accounting, and each one has presaged a massive uptick in global wealth, right? In complexity. Right? When you had single entry accounting, the only money that moved around was between kings and queens. And we think we have a 1% problem now. We don't know shit. Go back 1,000 years. You want to see a 1% problem when the kings and queens had all the freaking money, right? Go back 100 years into China when the feudal lords could kill you and owned all of the money. And 99% of the people toiled their whole life to pay 75% back taxes. Right? So the way that the idea that we could actually distribute the money out quickly so that everyone could start doing shit with it instead of putting it in the closet, that is really important. And nobody has solved that. And so the way that I tried to solve that was by building on top of the identity, I unify the miner and the client, right? And by doing that, it holds the possibility that you don't allow people to get hundreds of miners and invest in like specialized ASICs and all these things, which again are only going to put it into the realm of the people who can afford it, which again brings you to the centralization problem. So if anyone is only allowed to have one miner because it's linked to your identity, and everyone is randomly drafted into a pool, so you're just walking along and your cell phone wakes up for 10 minutes and it's doing some calculations to secure the network, and then it goes back to sleep, and you might have a chance to get some coins. You're doing normal things on the network. You're chatting, you're forming groups, you're contributing code, you're doing whatever the hell, you're getting a taxi, you're doing whatever you want to do with it in the normal world, and all of a sudden you look, and now you've got these coins. And now you're a part of the system. Now you can go buy shit, right? Now you can participate in the system, right? And when we find that we enable more people to participate in the system, this is not socialism, this is common freaking sense. That's why when you go out to like third world countries and they do this micro lending, they find that that creates more uplift for an individual than going out there and giving them like a gazillion dollars in aid, right? You give, you know, some poor gal, right, the ability, $50 or whatever, which in her country is the ability to buy 5 chickens and start a chicken business, right? You know, in her town, all of a sudden you've just uplifted the whole freaking town, right? And you've allowed people to participate in the system. So, you know, I get very passionate about that side of it, as you can tell, because I think that people just get, you know, they just, you know, we have this rise of insanity in the world of like, you know, of sort of these two collective factions, right? Like we're either going to be isolationist or we're going to be socialist. And the world is not black and white. That's for morons. Morons. Okay? The world is a complex gray area, right? And the more money that's moving around, the more complex the system is, the more cool shit we can do, the more things we can invent, the more businesses we can start. So the faster we figure out a way to do that, instead of putting all the crypto coins into, you know, a bunch of freaking pockets in somebody's like secret data center in China, right? Like that's not helping anybody. That didn't solve any freaking problem, except that guy got rich and everyone else is poorer for it.
Exactly.
Right? You see what I mean?
Yes, exactly. I mean, you get really passionate about that, and I can feel with you. I believe strongly in singularity. And we are living in a time where many of those ideas just pop up on different spots of the world at the same time, where people just get these crazy ideas, even though they never met before. Maybe they even didn't read the same books, but they have the same ideas. We're living in a kind of awakening time, to my opinion. It's just in the beginning. And a lot of those crazy ideas you have, I have myself. Yeah. So, and it's quite funny to meet now people through a hangout. They are living all on the other side of the planet. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And we share the same ideas. I mean, what you're saying is nailing it. It's beautiful. I give you just one example, putting on top of what you said now. I'm strongly against that the governments are now trying in Europe, in Finland, they are starting a pilot project to invent the basic income. I'm strongly against it because it's robbery. It's stolen money. It's like Robin Hood taking money away and then spending it to low income people without, they are not part of the system. Yeah. So you just take stolen money, suck energy out from wealthy people, and just throw it to unwealthy people without anything. Yeah. This will not work. But what you said, Daniel, there is a slightly difference. Yeah. It's just a tiny difference, and it makes the whole system working differently. We can solve this universal income problem very easily with something like staking. Blockchain money like PIVX and other POS systems are using the staking feature. So if you have your wallet running and it's just spending a little bit of CPU time, coins are generated automatically, each 30 seconds, each minute, whatever. You just solve this problem while creating fiat money, while creating out of something, out of compute, spending computer time, creating a coin, you distribute it directly. Yeah? And from that moment, your phone, as you said, your phone is waking 10 minutes using computer processing power, maybe to help developing researching genomes or medications or something like that. Whatever, yeah, we can do it really for a greater good, whatever. Yeah, and you get suddenly some coins. You're part of the system. Yeah, no money was taken away from somebody. Nothing was stolen. Nothing is redistributed. Nothing is it has nothing to do with socialism. Yeah, in fact, it's liberating people. It's empowering people. Yeah? And we can solve this problem with the blockchain and money creation. Yeah, it's quite easily. We just have to do it. And when our cyberspaces develop maybe different currencies, one cyberspace will make a currency which is staking a lot. The other cyberspace says, no, we like to have more digital asset like gold, whatever. Let them try and do it. But when they all use the same governance system, it's beautiful. We can see how people can research their own stuff, do their own stuff, and be part of the system and participate in something where they feel they are part of something greater. And that empowers the individual, and then you have more freedom, like living in a cold individualistic world. Yeah, where everybody tries to hoard and get some and hoard for himself. That's not helping the planet. And we are solving, like the Venus Project, problems that sound maybe like a socialistic experiment. But what we are doing, in fact, is we are empowering people and giving the individual more knowledge, more power, more possibilities than ever before. And not the 1% there. This is really, I like it. I love it. So no, I'm quiet.
Well, so you share my passion for it. And I'll just say this. I mean, the problem is that we have a system that basically evolved like through brute force, right? It's essentially the way we distribute wealth is asinine, right? And I don't mean distribute wealth like take money and distribute it. Like these phrases become poisoned as people discuss things over time. It's like this quantum problem. Everybody, you know, this person is a socialist and hears it one way. This person's a communist, hears it another way. This person's libertarian and hears it a different way. But the truth is over here. Again, we're all points on the sphere. We never fully are communicating the way that we want to, right? The words come out of my mouth, but they may mean something different to you when they're processed in your head, right? That's the challenge of communication. But what I'm looking at is in the past, the way that wealth was distributed is a bunch of kings and queens who were the strongest and most violent authoritarians who ever lived essentially said, well, we'll get a bunch of people and we'll make them dig shit out of the ground and we'll build shiny shit with it and then we'll control everyone. And that was pretty much the state of the world. And that's how money got developed. It went down to the dukes and then a little of it got parceled out. But people didn't have a job. Their job was to subsistence farm or whatever. So really the concept of now wealth creation now is, well, now you have a job. And this is really only a 200-year-old creation. People don't understand. They go, oh my God, what will we do without freaking jobs? They're like, well, for thousands of years, we didn't have a job except farming and eating, right? And then you traded shit, right? You did, you know, you were a carpenter or whatever, and you did things. But now we've evolved to a new level of complexity, and we're like, okay, we'll give you some money if you work. Okay, and that's the best thing that we've come up with in terms of distributing out the cash so that more people can participate in the system. And no matter what anybody thinks, the statistics do not bear out that we are going backwards. More people are participating in the system. More people are in the middle class. There was just the statistics professor who died. Go Google the greatest statistics you'll ever see. And it's absolutely one of the best links of all time. And you'll see that our perception of where the world is going into this like shithole versus actually more and more people are participating as we increase in complexity. We have an opportunity to increase complexity again. And the best way to do that is to as we're generating the money this time, because really all this money is invented, right? Cryptocurrency is, we're making this shit up out of thin air. Every currency we made up out of thin air, guess what? It's all fiat currency. Don't use the word fiat anymore. Cryptocurrency is fiat too. We just made this shit up just like the guys before. And by the way, gold is fiat too. We just made that shit up. We pulled some shit out of the ground. We go, oh, this is shiny. It has value. Why does it have any value? It has no fucking value except that we decided it had value. Okay. So the best thing we can do now is, as we're generating this new money, right, is figure out how to get it out to people as quickly as possible. So in other words, instead of starting with five guys having it and then trickling it down to everyone. Why not just fire it out to everybody? Everybody's got some coin. And then the most industrious folks will figure out a way to set up a business and they'll get more of the coin. Like they want. Everybody wants to get more coin. You'll still have the opportunity to get more coin. This isn't you're only allowed 50 coins and you'll never have any more, right? This is just a way to distribute out the cash as it's being produced so that more people can do more interesting shit. How many people would have a business who don't have the opportunity to do so, right? I read about a guy who his father was a programmer. And you wouldn't think his father never, he was a COBOL programmer and he never really updated his skills, right? And over time, as time went by, he found it harder and harder to get a job. Eventually he lost his job, right? And then he's working as a bus driver, right? And he no longer has an up-to-date computer anymore. And he can't afford to just go buy a $50 book on Java and a decent computer to buy anything anymore. And by the way, now he's working all day at a shitty job that he hates. Yeah, he made a mistake in that he didn't update his skills better, right? But how many people are stuck in that kind of rut where they can't update their skills, right? Without an act of God, right? Without an ability to how many people want to be able to contribute and could contribute a billion new ideas and aren't able to do so because they're locked into basically the modern equivalent of subsistence farming, right? Working at a crappy job, 80 hours that they hate, and there's sort of no way to get it, there's no way to dig out of it, right? If we, if we change that dynamic, but then you have this like explosion, this Cambrian explosion of new ideas, businesses, complexity, wealth, all of these types of things that everybody wants. And we just have to let go of our limited labeling and thinking of these types of things for it to be a possibility.
So we had some tone problems. So could you hear Sarah now? Huh?
No,
me neither. Okay, good. Okay, so we'd like to finish now the talk. We had a really nice, decent talk, I think, and it was very enlightening, to my opinion. And I'm happy that we get to know each other now. So, and that the community has a chance to get to know Guillermo and to get to know Daniel. And from now on, the next month, I think, we will walk at least on the same roads and try to solve the problems together, I think. That's for sure, right? Yes, cool. Nice.
Sure.
Okay, guys, so I finish it now. It's hard to understand Sarah. She has to buy probably a better microphone. So, okay, guys, see you later. We talk soon. We see us in the Slack channel or keep in touch with chats or email. And hopefully we do this hangout sessions from now on quite regularly and quite more often. I think this is good for the community so that our project, Cicada and Fermat, now step into the public and present the world what we are thinking. I mean, what we are doing. I mean, we are gathering brilliant minds in our projects and around our projects. Yeah. What is happening here is something, this is awesome. A lot of crypto projects out there don't realize that we are thinking about problems to solve that belong to mankind. Yeah? And it's not just, we are not solving a specific problem to make business, we are solving mankind problems. Yeah? And this is huge. And so, yeah, I'm looking forward to working together with you guys. See you.
Thank you. Thank you all. See you.
Good talk. Thank you.
Bye-bye.